Hello, welcome. Welcome everyone that's joining. Looks like we have some folks coming into the room. Thanks so much for spending this beautiful Wednesday evening with us. We're just going to give everyone a couple of minutes to join in. Like we just have a couple more folks joining. We'll give them just about 30 seconds. Okay, welcome. Let's go ahead and get started. My name's Rebecca Ramsey and I'm the executive director at Swan Valley. Swan Valley Connections is a collaborative conservation and education organization located in the part of the Swan Valley, roughly halfway between Missoula and Glacier National Park, flanked by the Bob Marshall Wilderness to our east and the Mission Mountain Wilderness to the west. And we are so grateful to be here tonight with all of you and some of our really incredible partners. And that's what tonight is all about, is talking about the value of partnership here in our region as we prepare to watch the Life in the Land film. And so tonight is part of what Swan Valley Connections' goal is, to people to the natural world in a lot of different ways, from working with private landowners and with all of our agencies and our tribal partners to do great conservation work on the ground, as well as to offer visitor services and educational opportunities to people of all ages. And our monthly educational series that happens on the first Wednesday of every month is one of the ways that we aim to connect people to the natural world and to complete our mission at Swan Valley Connections of inspiring conservation and expanding stewardship of the Swan Valley. So to do that tonight, we were very fortunate to be partnered with Laura Tomoff, who is the filmmaker of The Life in the Land, Gordy Sanders, who is the resource manager for Pyramid Mountain Lumber down in Seeley Lake, Ron Swaney, the fire management officer for the Confederated Salish and Kootenai tribes, and Caryn, Miske, the executive director of Clearwater Resource Council, also in Seeley Lake. And so tonight, what we're going to do is a little different than our usual format. I'm going to turn it over to Laura so she can tell you about the film, and she'll be facilitating the panel discussion tonight. And just a reminder that this program is being recorded, and so we will share this recording back out with everyone that is on our mailing list. And if you'd like to join that, you can contact us at SwanValleyConnections.org. It will also be on our YouTube and Facebook pages, so we'll make sure that everybody can see this far and wide. So Laura, without any further ado, I'd love to turn it over to you and tell us about this incredible effort.
Thank you so much, Rebecca, and thank you to Swan Valley Connections for hosting this screening. Thank you to our panelists to show up and offer your wisdom after the film screening, and to everyone for tuning in to view and share in this messaging. So just a brief background on the Life in the Land project as a whole. It started about a year ago as approached by a group of folks that were involved in collaborative conservation themselves, folks in watershed groups, NGOs, conservation, ranchers, different entities that worked and lived closely connected to Montana's landscapes, and who wanted to further this narrative of collaborative work on the land, because they were a part of it and they knew it was happening all over. But sometimes a lot of the narrative that we see can be divisive and different entities at odds with each other. And we all witness that ourselves too. There's truth in that. But to just really elevate this value in coming together on the landscape and hearing different perspectives and hearing different needs so that we can foster better relationships, not only with one another, but also between ourselves and the land. And so that kind of became the underlying theme of the Life in the Land project. And over the last year, I was traveling around the state, filming with different folks, and we culminated with 4 films and 18 podcast episodes. And we just launched those last month, and they can all be found at lifeintheland.org. And we'll be screening tonight the film episode from the Seeley-Swan region. And we really wanted these films to not only share with the general public, to show the nuance in all of these concepts, not only nuance in these communities, but also in the issues and the livelihoods and the dynamics and the complexities of what it is to foster healthy landscapes and communities. So not only for the general public, but also for the films to be used as a tool for anyone for free to use to kick off workshops, events, community gatherings from large to small, whether it's just folks meeting at your town hall or large regional conferences, to use these films to kind of kick off a deeper discussion about these concepts and dive into deeper dialogue about how this collaborative, holistic approach can be applied in your own region, as well as to elevate and give pride to the communities that are featured in the films. So we encourage anyone to let folks know about it, or if you yourself could use any of the films in your own work to kick off workshops or gatherings, they're free and available for the public. So we encourage you to check it out on lifeintheland.org, as well as each interview in the film. In this film, you'll hear from 5 folks, and each of their interviews can be, you know, about an hour in reality when we were with them, and that it's such deep, rich information. And so if you want to take a deeper dive into a specific subject, each interview is its own podcast episode that is on Apple and Spotify on the Stories for Action podcast series. So you can check those out. They're also on the lifeintheland.org site. And with the Seeley-Swan region episode specifically, a lot of folks around the state in Montana, it's a common term to say the Seeley-Swan, but of course, between the Swan Valley and the Clearwater watershed, which includes Seeley Lake, very different ecosystems, different watersheds, obviously, different communities. So we're hearing from folks from both of those places, as well as from Confederated Salish and Kootenai tribes and folks in the Flathead Reservation jurisdiction, just over the Mission Mountains. And that's an important part of the story of the land in the Seeley-Swan, not only to show those historical connections of the Salish, Kalispe, and Kootenai folks with the Seeley-Swan Valley, but also present day connections as they share jurisdictional boundaries, and to really show that importance of working across jurisdictional boundaries and different lines that humans like to create, the ecosystems and wildlife and forest fires don't care anything about. So just how to further that dialogue between jurisdictions. So you'll hear from folks from all of those areas and kind of this overlapping of how we can live in better relationship with one another and with the land to help both the health of communities and the landscape. So with that, I will go ahead and start the film. It runs about 30 minutes, and then stick around for the Q&A afterwards with the folks featured in the film. And as Rebecca mentioned, you can put your questions during the screening into the Q&A chat there as well. And we'll come to them afterwards. So.
It's a really special place in that it is really wild, one of the last truly wild places. It's also still a working landscape where humans live here, living off and with the land.
We all work together, but truly respect our natural resources and like to see them not only thrive, but expand in a sustainable way long-term.
We've used both sides of the mountains for millennia, and we see the importance of working with folks on the other side of the mountain because it's part of our Aboriginal territory and it's part of our ecosystem.
Located within one of the last intact large landscapes on the planet, known as the crown of the continent ecosystem, lies Montana's Seeley-Swan Region. This region lies between two wilderness complexes and consists of two different watersheds, the Swan Valley, which flows to the north, and the Clearwater watershed, which flows to the south. The rural communities who live and work within this landscape are primarily engaged in the economies of the timber industry, forestry, outdoor recreation, and conservation, and are largely dependent upon the rich biodiversity that thrives here. The connected habitats that sustain these species, some of which are endangered, continue to prosper due to the proactive human efforts made by those who have strong connections to these lands. This coexistence will only endure if those efforts continue and are supported. Human connections to this land began over 10,000 years ago. While it was primarily the territory of the Upper Kalispell, the Salish, Kootenai, and many other indigenous tribes interacted with and stewarded these valleys. Indigenous relationships with this region continue today through ongoing cultural connections and ecosystems that span current tribal jurisdiction. The Flathead Reservation, home of the Confederated Salish and Kootenai tribes, lies directly over the mountains to the west and holds the nation's first tribally managed wilderness. In the late 1800s, with increasing encroachment by white settlement and resource industries, the U.S. military invaded and forced native tribes in the area onto reservations. The treaty guaranteed rights for tribes to continue traditional practices on ancestral homelands outside of the reservations were suppressed, often violently. This suppression occurred in the Seeley-Swan region partially in response to private interests demanding protection of the timber in the region, which they now saw as a commodity. Throughout the 20th century, the Seeley-Swan was primarily managed for timber harvesting, which continues today. In the 1990s, Plum Creek Timber Company, which at the time was the largest private landowner in the country, transitioned into real estate development and began listing tens of thousands of acres for private development. The threat of subdividing and habitat fragmentation brought together unlikely partnerships of residents and groups with varied interests, including loggers and conservation advocates, who were all concerned about the sustainable future of the region. After years of public and private efforts, from grassroots level to national, a deal was reached in 2008 for the remainder of Plum Creek's lands. This came to be known as the Montana Legacy Project, putting over 310,000 acres in the greater region of Montana into primarily public lands and conserved spaces. The success of the Montana Legacy Project was dependent on the collaborative groups who had already been working for years in the region to build a culture of shared stewardship, watershed by watershed. Swan Valley Connections is one of the locally led organizations that carries on this legacy today. They work to inspire a healthy coexistence of people and place in the Swan Valley. They coordinate resources to carry out programs on the ground, including public outreach concerning living in bear habitat, wildfire fuels mitigation, responsible timber harvesting, citizen science, and educational programs for all ages. Swan Valley Connections proves that locally led collaborative efforts are critical to creating healthy lands and communities.
Nothing we do is without partners. It's all about relationship building and trust and nurturing that. That takes a lot of time. We need to have the patience to come together with curiosity, we can then open ourselves to hear those other perspectives and find some sort of middle ground. Being willing to learn together in public is really key. And as conditions change, so do the things that we know. And that's part of the need for collaboration. All of our experiences of living and working in this wild landscape makes it really important for people to bring their knowledge, their passion into the room so that we can work together. It's really important to be present in decision-making opportunities, being a part of public comment periods, being on city councils. We work hard to get our county elected officials to come out to the far reaches of the county out here because it's very different than it is in the heart of Missoula, for instance. Nobody knows a place better than the people who live and work there. The Swan watershed is the wettest in the state of Montana, with 16% surface water and more than 4,000 wetlands. We have 93% public land, so that allows for a lot of rare animals and plant species to exist here, including kind of the full suite of Montana carnivores, grizzly bears, wolverines, mountain lions, lynx, and a host of other animals that have mostly free movement. It is a wild place to live. The people here are independent thinkers and also always come together as a community whenever it's needed. We are a headwaters into the Flathead system, and Montana as a state is the headwaters to the continent. We have the opportunity to demonstrate what healthy waterways look like. As the climate is changing, as we see climate refugees that want to move into these wild places that have an abundance of water, without careful planning and acknowledging that ground to surface water connection, we run the risk of running out of water. It's not an infinite resource. There's a real need to continue to fund research and monitoring so that we can come up with solutions and we can inform those policy decision makers about what's really happening on the ground. I'm a real believer in trying to nurture our adaptive management skills. Change is constant. How can we be resilient in change? We're all here, no matter what your species, to learn and teach one another. We are on what we call the Elk Creek Conservation Area. It is 640 acres that Swan Valley Connections owns and manages in partnership with the Confederated Salish and Kootenai tribes. Elk Creek is the primary bull trout spawning tributary in the whole Swan watershed system. Swan Ecosystem Center approached the Confederated Salish Kootenai tribes, understanding that bull trout is culturally significant, as is water, very culturally significant to the tribes, and wanted to offer a partnership opportunity to them. We're always working together to try to improve this piece of property, whether that's to increase the diversity of the native plant species, to using it for educational purposes, and always keep this waterway clean, cold, connected, allowing it to utilize its full floodplain by not building any structures ever on this property, and let it be its wild, beautiful self. Part of Swan Valley Connections values is valuing traditional indigenous knowledge and trying to incorporate traditional ecological knowledge into all of our work. And so we are constantly learning and look forward to continuing to learn and bring those learning opportunities to a greater public. Frankly, we're overdue in honoring and living in more of a community with indigenous peoples. As an organization, ours and others, it's also really important to not just have one tribal member or one type of person, not just any one belief system, age, gender. We all belong. We're all a part of that interconnected web of life. While we try to increase the Earth's capacity, we increase our own capacity for learning and partnership.
I'm a Confederated Salish Kootenai tribal member, born and raised here on the Flathead Indian Reservation. Spent a lot of time with the elders when I was younger, really learned the importance of taking care of the land, being connected to the land. Historically, the Confederated Salish Kootenai tribes had a very large Aboriginal territory.
Seeley-Swan was important for many reasons.
When I've interviewed my elders about traditional uses of certain areas in Aboriginal territory, they talked about the Swan Valley as being really important for big game, bear, elk, and such. And there's a lot of culturally modified trees back there too, that the bark was taken off for the use of food, for cambium. There was large stands of white pine. We used the bark off of those white pine for canoes.
It was just the main travel corridor and part of the area that we called home. So our reservation border ends on the tips of the missions and follows the ridgeline south. We've used both sides of the mountains for millennia, and we see the importance of working with folks on the other side of the mountain to make sure that our treatments here don't stand alone and their treatments there don't stand alone, that we cross boundary, we work in collaboration. Currently, we're working with TNC, BLM, within the Swan area over there to bring fire back to some of their land to rejuvenate that ecosystem there. We work well with all of our neighbors. It's learning both ways. We see it as important to us because it's part of our Aboriginal territory and it's part of our ecosystem.
For over a century, forest management on the Flathead Reservation was held by federal agencies. In 1996, management was transferred to the Confederated Salish and Kootenai tribes, who had stewarded these lands for thousands of years.
Our forest management plan is a very unique blend of Western science and traditional ecological knowledge. So when we developed our plan, we really wanted to get away from production forestry. We see what the land needs. It's based on ecosystem balance, wildlife needs, even cultural use. We try to incorporate all those components into every plan. Every community member, non-tribal and tribal, they have some input of what goes on up here.
Since time immemorial, Indigenous peoples of the region understood fire as a necessary component of healthy forest and grassland ecosystems. Oral histories and scientific evidence show that for thousands of years, the vast majority of fires in these areas were intentionally set by Indigenous peoples for specific land management purposes.
Traditionally, wildfire was allowed to burn on these lands. And historically, our tribe set prescribed fires for different reasons. It could be for hunting and grazing areas. We would set them at the right time of year for berry picking. And a lot of times it was for maintenance of campsites, for grazing of our horses. We'd have a firekeeper that would go around these different areas, and based on, you know, the traditional ecological knowledge of knowing when to burn, what areas to burn, with the understanding that fire is part of this ecosystem and understanding the use and the good of fire.
With the influx of white settlement in the mid-1800s, government officials frequently suppressed wildfires and restricted Indigenous peoples from carrying out traditional uses of burning, often using direct violence. In 1910, massive wildfires burned 3 million acres of the inland Northwest. The devastating scale of these fires was due to a variety of factors, including the previous decades of fire suppression and the resulting buildup of fuels. After the fires of 1910, U.S. Forest Service management further ramped up tactics to suppress wildfire. Today, the Confederated Salish and Kootenai Tribes Forestry Department is reintroducing their traditional relationship with fire into their management plan to restore cultural uses of areas, improve the health of the ecosystem, and to reduce the risk of catastrophic-sized wildfires. They also use strategic thinning practices which promote the health of old-growth forest ecosystems and lowers the intensity of prescribed burns.
When we do a project site, we like to consult with our elders, getting that culture involvement, you know, learning from our elders of different management areas, what that area used to be like, what was its function, what native plants were there, helps us guide our treatment plans. We're still learning from our ancestors.
What I've seen is once we introduce fire into the landscape, the vegetation gets renewed. It increases the browse species for animals. We've seen native plants come back that were laying dormant. With the reintroduction of fire, if we lift all the branches that are available to a flaming front up, so the trees have less ability to torch. It's very evident in this particular stand. If you had a fire in here, it would typically just be a surface fire now. If we want to protect our resources from wildfire, we got to reintroduce fire. Welcome to a fire-dependent ecosystem.
Our forests are finally catching up to that impact of fire suppression over 100 years. Fire season is getting longer with climate change, and that aligned with the structure of the forest right now, with the density, it's really setting it up for big events.
You look at fire seasons of today, and you know, I like to compare them to when I first started, and it's not even close. It's crazy how early the fire season starts, the type of weather that we've been getting. This year, we saw a shortage nationally of firefighting resources. It draws more importance on the interagency relationship. We all come together and we talk about the fire season. We start talking about resources that we have, fire danger that we're looking at. We call in resources from different agencies, tribes, Bureau of Indian Affairs, Eastern Oklahoma region, Navajo region. They come in every year. And the reason we ride with that group, they know our ground, we know them, and the relationship's established that we work well together. On the other hand, now they're in trouble, they're having hard times with their fires, so our resources are down there helping them.
That's the importance of collaboration, of seeing a bigger picture. It's not just ownership of parcels, it's not productivity of forest logging, it's ecosystem balance and restoration needs of the landscape.
What's unique about Seeley Lake is the fact this year everything can coexist. We have a great recreational attraction with the lakes, and in the wintertime there's cross-country skiing. It's a small community, everyone knows everybody, but truly respect our natural resources. And it's a matter of working with others and coming up with projects that actually benefit all the different interests that exist.
Pyramid Mountain Lumber is the largest employer in the Seeley Lake area and the oldest surviving family-owned lumber mill in Montana. Since it began operations in 1949, Pyramid has deemed itself the Forest Stewardship Company, understanding the interconnectedness of landscape health with the sustainability of natural resources and community well-being.
Working at Pyramid, our owners definitely emphasize community involvement. When they posted the job, and one of the key things they said was, you have to be part of the community. You know, we want to help our employees and keep Seeley Lake thriving. We may only have 120 employees, but we support probably double that outside the mill in terms of those loggers and the businesses and the landowners and the Forest Service.
Most of the harvesting that occurs in the whole Seeley-Swan Valley is kind of selective harvesting, but it provides long-term benefits for wildlife, recreation, as well as raw materials in the future. You're doing other things other than just harvesting sawlog-sized trees, you know, improving streams for fish passage and dealing with legacy roads that produce sediment or bull trout streams. All of Seeley Lake is occupied grizzly bear habitat. Certainly road density is an issue. So if part of a project, we can obliterate some roads, you know, in a thoughtful way. I think there's ways of doing things that benefit other interests. What's interesting about Pyramid Mountain Lumber, we've never owned any of our own land. Therefore, we're totally dependent on all our forest landowners, federal, state, private, tribal. And so developing long-term relationships with a wide variety of interests have been incredibly beneficial. We can't do this by ourselves. We got to develop partnerships with other folks with different interests where we can come up with objectives on the ground where everybody sees some part of their interest in the end result. It's very important that a collaborative is balanced, meaning you've got environmental interests, you've got community interests, resource interests, all kind of working together and looking out for each other's interests. Over the course of time, that's exactly what happens. The other venue that's out there is the collaborative process, you know, to get someone locally to kind of convene stakeholders. And you may only meet once or twice. You have some discussion, go on a field trip, provide some input, and then you disband. So you don't have to meet every single month. You know, I chair the Montana Forest Collaboration Network, but right now there's 23 collaboratives. And I think that provides a good medium to have a good conversation about how do we grow the footprint of collaboration across Montana and elsewhere. You know, pool resources, do something that's really at a landscape level that makes a difference. Pyramid Mound Lumber joined the Sustainable Forestry Initiative in 2010. And the Sustainable Forestry Initiative is an international certifying body. We stay up to date with growing environmental kind of issues and concerns, climate change and biodiversity, to apply that to not only how we look at things, but how we communicate with other landowners. There is a new standard coming up that deals with climate smart forestry. And a lot of that revolves around basically mitigation and adaptation. We need to keep our forests healthy. And if we thin out our forests, trees grow faster, they get bigger faster, store more carbon, rather than let all the fuels accumulate and then go up in smoke.
The community of Seeley Lake has experienced multiple area wildfires throughout the years. In 2017, the Rice Ridge Fire burned 156,000 acres from July through September and threatened Seeley Lake's town center.
Those fires really brought an awareness to the community of this is really dangerous. We've got to do something about it. We need to maintain our forests so we don't burn down.
The more we can manage, the less catastrophic wildfire there is. Instead, let's use prescribed fire. This site right here is one of the sites when the tribes came through, they stopped here and they would burn this area regularly. Tribes have used Montana's forested land forever. You know, a significant amount of our volume every year comes from tribal sources, which we're very dependent on. They do a great job managing their forest land.
The Clearwater Resource Council is another group that was involved in the success of the Montana Legacy Project. They're a resident-driven organization which creates programs and local engagement around topics of water quality issues, community development, and ecosystem health in the Clearwater Valley.
We are located in Seeley Lake, which is in the heart of the Clearwater Valley and the Clearwater watershed. What really makes the Clearwater unique is its long string of lakes. The water resources here provides the unique wildlife habitat for a whole host of creatures. I would say it's a disparate community in that you have a community of retirees who tend, for the most part, to be in the upper economic demographic. And you have local folks, sometimes who have been here for generations and are mostly working folks.
The year-round population of Seeley Lake averages 2,000. In the summer months, the population swells to over 6,000, and several hundred thousand tourists visit the area. While tourism creates a beneficial boost to the local economy, this influx can also create pressures on the community and the environment. The region's attraction for seasonal residents and remote workers has created a severe lack of available and affordable housing for local working residents.
If we want to keep folks on the landscape, and if we want to make the housing affordable, and if we want to make sure there are jobs, and at the same time protecting the environment, we're going to have to work hard at that. It doesn't just happen. You have to involve those folks who live there. It's really important that it's a collaborative effort rather than a top-down effort. Clearwater Resource Council wanted to contribute to climate change mitigation in a meaningful way. And so currently we're working with the Missoula Electric Co-op, the Bonneville Environmental Foundation, to facilitate a solar installation here in Seeley Lake. Bonneville Environmental Foundation would provide $50,000 to offset the cost to purchase panels to low-income residents. We can address some of the equity issues that have plagued and are plaguing this community. The solar panels, if you buy one, give you a monthly rebate on your electric bill. Our hope is that we will encourage other folks to install solar installations on their own private homes. I don't think climate change is anywhere near as controversial as it was 10 years ago. I think the greater challenge is, what do we do about it and what does that look like? And you need to start thinking kind of creatively. So it's our job to educate folks and say, yeah, this is happening, but we can make it a little better. There's lots and lots of impacts, but I mean, the two that I think are most evident is longer, hotter, drier summer seasons, which translates into more risk for catastrophic wildfire. CRC has spent hundreds of thousands of dollars working with community members to mitigate their properties and to reduce the threat of wildfire. The other thing that is really significant is that we've had an uptick in blue-green algae blooms. While not all blue-green algae is toxic, it certainly can be toxic, and the impact to waterfowl and the impact to even terrestrial species who drink from a fouled lake are deadly. This means that folks pulling their water from the lake can no longer pull their water from the lake or have to be very careful in the use of that water. We're trying to study that more. So this year we're doing a full baseline analysis on all six major lakes. It is important for people to kind of understand that natural world. I think if we don't connect people and they don't see the importance of it, then we're going to continue to lose natural resources on the landscape.
A sense of place is very important and is part of my teachings. A sense of place is being greater than just, oh, this is a pretty landscape here. There's a deeper story which makes the landscape kind of come alive better. Those stories are culturally relevant to our tribes, the Salish, Kalispe, and the Kasanka people. Our sciences and our connection to the landscape are embedded in those stories. A lot of the place names of these areas, they can also be descriptive of what kind of resources are there. And if you imagine us traveling through the mountains here, the Mission Mountains, all the way to the Rocky Mountain front, where you got the Missouri River, the Musselshell, the Yellowstone Rivers, all those areas, we have place names out there. There was important resources that we were going to. And to have the many data sets in your mind to be able to identify those plants and to be able to be there at the time of maturity and at the right time to collect and to process those resources took a great amount of indigenous sciences, and it was developed over thousands of years, maybe tens of thousands of years of knowing a place, of being part of this place that helps you to feel and to be a part of this landscape to where you can start defining where you are in this cosmos and your relationship to all that's around you. My personal connection with the environment around me has led me to work with our youth and to work with our families on the reservation to help them make that connection with their culture and with the environment around them.
Tim conducts Indigenous educational outreach through many avenues, including leading the Mission Mountain Youth Crew.
Other partners were the parents that encouraged their kids to enroll in this program. We had 8 reservation youth involved with this program for 7 weeks during the summer months, and we did forest restoration work, everything from opening trails up, cleaning campgrounds, studying insects, to banding birds, to snorkeling into the rivers and doing fish surveys. We also did cultural resource management work too, which I was able to convey to them the history and the traditional uses of these areas. That's another opportunity, is that they understand their Aboriginal territory and not just the reservation. And so try to get them to feel some ownership. When we're brushing out and opening up a trail that was used by our ancestors, I want them to realize that and reflect on that and feel that, okay, you know, my ancestors are here with me. We had a participant, she said, wow, I can go home and I can tell my parents about this. I can tell my friends about this stuff now. And the Mission Mountain Youth Crew was formed not only to just to make that connection with the environment and the community, but also to make the connection to their future careers and what they may aspire to. The important thing is realizing your own worldview and where do you stand. With that is the consideration of your family, community, and the world in general and your effects on it. And if we can truly embody that belief and that feeling that we are part of everything around us, that we would start thinking more seriously about polluting our lands, our endangered species, animals that are disappearing from the earth because of our effect, the climate change, and how that's affecting everything and everyone on this earth, how it affects us culturally. We need to be conscious of that. In a community, in a tribal unit, everyone was valued for what they contributed as a team, as a group, as a community to move forward generation upon generation, and here we are. Where are we going in the future? You know, that's a huge question.
I have spent, you know, my adult life in this incredible state, and to be in the Crown is amazing. I just hope more people just recognize that coming together is the only way that we're going to get anywhere. Rural communities, I think, really show that. You might be completely politically opposed, but somebody's house is burning down, your enemy is going to be the first one there to help put it out. Why does it take tragedy for us to come together? How about we come together to prevent the proverbial fire? I just think that the only way we're going to make it as a species is to come together.
Laura, thank you so much for that incredible film. It made me cry all over again. Excited to turn it over. I just wanted to just thank again all of our partnerships. What a beautiful thing.
For sure. Thank you all. Rebecca, I don't know if you could see the Q&A questions.
Let's see. I don't have any open questions right at the moment.
I'm just making sure I'm seeing the same thing. Okay, great. Then I will start with some questions for folks on the panel. And audience members, you can continue to drop in questions there in the Q&A as we go here. I'd like to open it up to Gordy Sanders, resource manager for Pyramid Mountain Lumber. I'm curious, you know, just in both you're chair of the Montana Forest Collaboration Network, as well as your work with Pyramid Mountain Lumber. And I'm curious, in both of those positions, any shifts that you've seen in the last decade or so of overall forest management approaches, you know, if that shifts with more of a focus on this collaborative approach of, you know, community guidance in the work, just general shifts that you've seen, or if you have seen any in the last decade of forest management, and also if there's a specific project that you want to mention that's utilizing those types of approaches that's going on now.
Thanks, Laura. No, I'd be glad to visit about, you know, the collaboration. You know, as chair of the Montana Forest Collaboration Network, seems like every year we're adding one more collaborative. We now have 24 collaborative members. The collaborative processes are going on all over the state, you know, across the country. If you take a look at, you know, the Montana Forest Action Plan, and then you think about the infrastructure bill and all the legislation that Congress has passed, you know, there's collaboration, collaborative efforts, that language is rolled into all of that legislation that's been carried forward, because it is the way to move forward, get more folks on board, to support projects so they can see more of their interest on the ground too. When we work together, it's far more beneficial for the public at large. And I think, and then what I've seen too is within the agencies, there's far more interaction, openness, transparency than we've ever seen in the past. So I think things are going incredibly well.
I know there's a lot of them, but is there a specific project that comes to mind that's in the process now of, you know, a plan that you see happening in a certain region, Montana, that is moving forward in this approach?
I think I see lots of them. I think, sure. You know, there's multiple examples of folks working together. You know, a new collaborative that came together is it Beaverhead County? Excuse me. And they're working on wilderness study areas to decide what kind of recommendation would make the most sense.
That's great. Yeah, and folks can check out the Montana Forest Collaboration Network too on their website. And it shows you all the different things that are going on around the state. And Rebecca, with Swan Valley Connections, one of the organization's many different programs and work that you guys are doing on the ground is the college course that you guys do in the summer, both the Wildlife in the West and Landscape and Livelihood courses, which folks can come from all over the state or international and have on the ground real life experience of working with that connection between community health, landscape health, and get college credit for that. If you want to just give a brief mention on that program. And then also I'm curious, you know, as you get students and young folks from all over the place, some of them from urban spaces. What are some of the perspectives that you've heard and feedback from those folks when they witness this, these connective approaches happening? You know, if it's like a big eye opener to them, if it's kind of crushed stereotypes that they may have had before. Just some like highlights of some of the feedback that you've seen. I think it helps for folks, those of us who are Montana residents, it helps us to see what perspectives folks coming from the outside might have when, if they get inspired when they see this approach.
Yeah, thank you so much for that opportunity. Our college programs are one of our many educational brings. And it's always exciting when we have the students in town. And like you said, they are from all over. And often it's really neat of Montanans and or students from one of the Montana universities, as well as having folks from across the country. And our Wildlife in the West program is actually in session right now. It ends this week. And the students just did their presentation, so this is great timing in which these students were also of different ages and all sorts of different backgrounds, including combat veterans. And it was really exciting to hear some of the things that they did come here with preconceived notions about, because we all do, right? And several of them were from urban spaces like Boston, and you know, talking about how I think the first thing is they all felt inspired, and most of them had never been to Montana, and that's pretty, you know, that's pretty frequent across many of our programs. And so it's sort of this mythical thing. And so a lot of them are in wildlife biology type programs. And so what they're learning about in a book is completely different when you get to actually experience it on the land. And so a lot of that is their feedback, and also the feedback of meeting people that they might have had notions about, like trappers, hunters, ranchers, loggers. And they come to find out is that those groups are all humans, and they all value those resources just as different way. And so they are inspired. What they have talked about is that they can learn what they have learned here, they can bring back into their home spaces. Almost every one of them mentioned that this has taught them to be a better listener, and that they have to listen in order to lead, and that humans are a part of the ecosystem, not apart from the ecosystem, and that we are all in this web of life together, and that there's so much more to consider than just the human need or just the animal need or just the plant need, that all of those needs are equal and the values are equal, and that we're all an equal part of the landscape. And so so I think that that is some of the things that is really magical to see and to hear about what they might have thought about. And the same even with fire. We've been talking a lot about fire. Getting to go into a fire mosaic, a mixed fire mosaic, and see what that does, to look at like the carnivore monitoring research that we've been doing for 10 years to see that fire isn't necessarily a bad thing. It's a change. And to then learn about the different management. And I think the other thing that they aren't learning in school necessarily or in urban environments is that partnership. And they also talk about learning the value of partnerships, and that they, all of us as citizens, are partners too, whether we know it or not. And so I think they gain a lot of awareness about their own role in society on the landscape, and also learning so much about all of the different careers that are out there too. It goes on and on, really, the list. But those are some of the highlights.
Yeah, no, it's, I mean, for folks that were from here or from elsewhere, I see why, like, I wanna go do the course, you know? Yeah, and it's that what you're saying, that importance in really seeing the gray areas in all of these concepts. And I think a lot of times we get our information, even residents within Montana, not even just folks outside of the state or in larger urban centers, we get a lot of the information around all of these concepts and these dynamics as very black and white. It can be in a lot of headlines and news and social media and that kind of thing. So just to really elevate that importance of having conversations with people on the ground and seeking out those stories from people on the ground. I think that's one thing that we hope that the Life and Land stories kind of show, is just that importance of that finding someone in that community or that demographic that, oh, I could never work with them, or they're hard to get along with, or use that motivation to seek them out and have a conversation. And I'm sure most folks would be surprised in how we need to really let that voice be louder than anything that's polarizing or black and white. And of course, landscapes are complex. So why would we try to put something so black and white on a extremely complex entity, including the human part of that?
Yeah, absolutely. They also, I would say they also they benefit from just being in a rural community. And also we spend time with everybody that's in this film too. And so they get to spend time with the tribes, and they get to spend time at Pyramid and whatnot. And so I think that rural learning too, the rural, that again, rural and urban aren't divided, we're connected. And so I think that's another really major thing too.
Absolutely. And it shows you too, that importance of, a lot of Swan Valley Connections work and everyone here, their work, it really focuses on how you have to, enrich the health of that rural community in order to benefit the health of the landscape that they're a part of, that how intricate those two concepts are, and how much the healthy landscape depends on a healthy community, not only folks being able to make a living on, where they live and to be there in a sustainable way, but also to be able to work together. As we, know, with the Montana Legacy Project, the only reason that happened is because people were able to set aside differences and come together. So it's really interdependent. And Ron, the fire management officer of the Confederated Salish and Kootenai tribes, thank you so much for being here.
Yeah.
And, you know, as we are seeing a larger drive in the, you know, nationally in the conversation about reintroducing prescribed burning to the landscape to benefit the health of the landscape. And one of those many benefits is to mitigate against larger catastrophic size wildfires. You know, that's a concept that the Confederated Salish and Kootenai tribes, as well as many other indigenous communities, have been practicing for tens of thousands of years, right? It's nothing new at all for indigenous folks. And so as mentioned in the film, and as you and your team really integrate that traditional knowledge and that relationship with fire and reintegrating that, it's a very unique perspective and a unique way to come about it. And the reasoning for incorporating prescribed burning and the way in which you go about it. I'm curious if your team has been working with neighboring jurisdictions or other places around the state in kind of a consultation position or just going out to actually help with some of those burning projects outside of the Flathead Reservation jurisdiction.
Yeah, so we are partnered up with the Bureau of Land Management and the Nature Conservancy doing some work in the Gold Creek area. And we've completed or helped or assisted in a number of ways. They've reintroduced fire to some culturally significant areas and talked with us as they did it in terms of trying to protect that and enhance that cultural resource for our tribes to carry it on further. So they've looked at reintroducing camas, reintroducing fired areas that had camas, reintroducing even beaver dams into areas that had beaver dams to reintroduce the water table to enhance the camas plants in that area. A place called Prim Meadow, they reintroduced fire. It was an area that was used as a camp for our ancestors. And, you know, they took special care and showed a lot of concern to protect and enhance the cultural resources there. So it's been a very valuable experience. We've talked with the state of Montana, trying to get into some agreements with them to help them to reintroduce fire. They're not a lot of fire experience. We do have some state land currently on the reservation, and we've worked with them in terms of in an agreement, looking at areas that we can treat together and things that we can do together, both on and off the reservation, to enhance their prescribed fire program. We've been in coordination and cooperation with the Bitterroot National Forest, looking at some of their lands right now, not to reintroduce fire, but they're incorporating us into their management scheme to look to protect and enhance resources. As you can see, prescribed fire is a big part of the way we manage our lands. As Tony, you know, identified, is that it's traditional ecological knowledge in combination with Western science. It's a centerpiece of our management strategy. And so reintroducing fire is very key to the biodiversity, maintaining a healthy ecosystem, protecting and enhancing cultural resources. And if put in the right spot, a prescribed burn could help protect our communities and our residences from catastrophic fire.
Thank you for that. Yeah, it's really interesting and exciting to see it expanding and that approach. And when you guys do work with those other locations, you know, places that have traditional cultural significance, what does that physically look like? Is it, you know, conversations beforehand? Does it include like site visits? And then are you actually there on the ground during the burning to kind of facilitate that, or is it all kind of beforehand dialogue?
So we We have worked with our cultural committees. The Nature Conservancy came and talked with the culture committee and talked about the project that they were looking at doing and the purposes behind it. I thought that was an interesting approach that they reached out and really wanted to incorporate, you know, our culture committee's views and ideas in their project. And they wanted to be up front and make sure that they understood what was going to go on. There's a Reserve Treaty Rights Lands Initiative, a funding program that comes out of the Bureau of Indian Affairs that promotes treating lands, Aboriginal lands, off that aren't currently tribal trusts. So looking at Forest Service, TNC FITs, even state, any lands that are currently not trust acres that are owned by another entity, managed by another entity, to work with them to try to protect and enhance either cultural resources or our boundaries, things of that nature. So we have been working with different entities looking at like the Lolo National Forest, our boundaries, the Nature Conservancy, because they own a lot of the Pump Creek land that we've had fires go towards them a few times, and then the Bureau of Land Management. I mean, it's opened up some doors, some avenues, some opportunities for us to work across agency boundaries that we didn't have in the past.
That's great. That's really interesting. It keeps you busy. And so that doesn't even include the actual firefighting that you guys also are the ones actively doing when that season comes.
Right. So another thing is, you know, they keep us in the loop. They invite us to the burns. If we have an opportunity, we've sent people to the burns. We're really trying to get an agreement in place. You know, it sounds great, cooperation and coordination and working across agency boundaries, but there's always those other things that we have to do to get in place that protect our employees and protect the Nature Conservancy or the Bureau of Land Management when we come together and work together. So it sounds easy. It sounds like it should be just, we'll come over with a couple engines, but it takes a little bit of work to get everything lined up in the legality side to participate. They've invited us over. In fact, our tribal council was there today to do, to look at the work that's getting done and to meet some of the folks that are part of getting the work accomplished off the reservation. And I think that's just, it shows how this funding opportunity is just building our relationships. And although it seems like it's taking a while, we're a long way from where we were before this initiative came out. So really enhanced our cooperation and coordination. It's just been a valuable experience for us. And then going to the burn site and looking at what they've done and talking with them and how they implemented the burn and some of the concerns and some of the thought processes was very valuable for me. It connected me and our program to our cultural history, to our ancestors. You know, I didn't know that that place existed until they did this project. And now I got to see it and you can feel it. When you go there, you can feel it.
That's powerful. Yeah, and to be able to be directly interacting and stewarding that land is special. Thank you for that. And Caryn, Caryn Miske is the Executive Director of Clearwater Resource Council, who also does a great deal of varied programs and things on the ground, from youth programs to research. And a lot of what your overall work is connecting folks to the health of the landscape and getting community involvement, as well as actual research, research work on the ground, and around whether that's, you know, around climate change impacts or otherwise. I'm curious, in the film you mentioned the with an effect of a changing climate and warming climate is the increase in blue-green algae blooms in the lakes in the Clearwater watershed. And that your organization was conducting baseline studies last year. If you want to speak to updates that you guys have with those studies, if they went through and kind of the different moving parts of entities that you guys work with when you're doing that study and where you plan to go move forward with it.
So in 2021, we did do nutrient sampling on the 6 major lakes in the Clearwater. Unfortunately, nutrient sampling gives you a very general sense of the health of each lake, but there's a lot of confounding factors. So for instance, if you have a lot of runoff in the spring, that can contribute to higher nutrient loads. So one of the things we're trying to do is get a much better handle on how much the built environment is contributing to increased blue-green algae blooms. And there's been a lot of speculation that septic systems in particular are driving the increase in blooms. So one of the things we're doing this year is we're using something called a fluorometer, and it's simply a tool that measures whitening agent. Whitening agent is derived from the detergents that go into your washing machine, into your septic, and then into the lake water. So if we come up with elevated whitening agent, what we say is we know that septic systems are leaching at a relatively high rate into the lakes, and that that could be a contributing factor. The reality is there hasn't been a lot of long-term study on green algae blooms, despite the fact that people are, of all the things we do, it's one of the things they're most interested in because people are worried about their pets, people are worried about their kids. So it gets a lot of attention. And our hope is that by getting this fluorometer data, we can give people a sense of, well, part of this trend to increase blooms has to do with how we're managing the upland environment. The other thing we're doing specific only to Seeley Lake is we will be collecting eDNA samples this year. So CRC has been working with the sewer board quite a bit over the last year. And one of the things that has become really clear is that the sewer board wasn't given a lot of information to work with, despite the fact that there's been decades of discussion about a sewer in Seeley Lake. When I asked to see the data, I was really surprised that there wasn't much data, including data related to surface water contamination from groundwater sources. So one of the things we're going to be doing this year for Seeley Lake is taking eDNA samples. Those eDNA samples will allow us to actually break down sources for E. coli. So for instance, let's say we take a water quality sample, we send it to the lab and it comes back and it says, well, 80% is human, 10% geese, 10% deer. So that we'll have a much better sense of, again, do we have a problem that we can start to address, or do we have a different problem that maybe is going to be a little bit harder to address? So we're hoping to give the sewer district some really basic information so that they can start to have the data that they need to make decisions. One of the things in the public dialogue, when we have the public attend some of the sewer board meetings, is there's a discussion about, well, we don't really have a septic problem. This has to do with a lot of geese in the lake. And, you know, I think it's really important for people to get a sense of how we're contributing, how the built environment contributes to what goes on in our lakes. So that was a long-winded answer to your initial question. But we're hoping that by this fall of this year, we will have not all the answers by any stretch, but we'll have a little bit better idea of what we're contending with.
Yeah, thank you for that. I think that's super interesting, but also, so it shows you the importance of that research and the data collection. And as Rebecca mentioned in the film, because SVC does a lot of work with that too, just the importance to fund and create those research programs for all of these elements, because otherwise, right, that does become the common narrative that it is a geese problem and not an actual, you know, like that's how those.
And you did ask who are the partners in this, and there's a wide range of partners. So everyone from DEQ and the Forest Service to the Flathead Lake Biological Station that helps us run our E. coli samples. And then at the end of the day, really what it comes down to is the residents who live on these lakes. If we have a problem, and it is likely that we do have a problem, At the end of the day, it's going to come back to the residents to say, okay, we want to deal with this. We want to figure out a solution. We want to do something to protect water quality, not just for us, but for the next generation and the next generation after that. So the hope is that, you know, we can have some better answers so that when people say, well, it's the geese, we can say, well, yeah, not really.
Right. No, especially as we only see human presence on lakes increasing. Rebecca, how are we doing with time? Do I have time to do another follow-up question with folks, or do you want to open it up?
No, sure. I think we're good to go. We don't have a lot of questions in the Q&A yet. And so folks, if you have questions out, please feel free to put them in there. Otherwise, yeah, I think you can do another round.
Okay. And just quick on that, Caryn, sorry. For folks that are in the Clearwater watershed area, is there a place that they can go to keep updated with the progress of this, or, you know?
They can go onto our website, crcmt.org. We also will be publishing some reports this fall and early fall, late fall in that time frame. So there'll be reports available on the website as well.
Okay, great, thank you. And just a follow-up question I'm going to ask to all the panelists. With you're all involved in very different work from one another. So in your specific work with yourself and your team's work, thinking in some of the challenges and walls that you might hit with your work, if there's any messages that you would like to get out there for a specific audience, you know, even if it's messages for the general public, certain policy concepts that could help your work move along better, or a message to an agency, or a message, a call to action for folks in how they can help your work to move along at a better way. And whether that's for the general public or otherwise, if there's folks from agencies here, any message you want to get out there? Because I think as we hear the needs of other entities and individuals and agencies, that it helps us to not only advocate for our own needs when we go to vote or have conversations with folks, but also to advocate for other folks that are in our communities or our own ecosystems. So Gordy, I'll start with you. Any messages for folks?
Well, thank you, Laura. You know, one of the bigger challenges as you think about folks working together is what's framed as collaborative capacity. And, you know, with turnover and collaborative efforts and people kind of get tired, collaborative fatigue is a word. And part of that comes from how long it takes for projects to move forward. You know, some projects can take, lightning speed is like 3 years. And then commonly it's 6 years to 10 years. And so you can't bring a bunch of folks together every month and talk about the same project every month, month after month, for 3 to 10 years. That doesn't work. So one, I think for the agencies, you know, really focusing on streamlining processes. They have a bunch of different tools, some that are provide more flexibility, and they're a lot more, convenient, shorter timelines. And I think too, part of it is there are a lot of new kind of rules and regulations that have come to be that actually are very beneficial. It's like not to enjoin a project unless it's likely to succeed on the merits in court. And so that's made a difference, where projects continue to go forward even though they're under litigation. And so many times the projects, we had one in the Swan Valley, it was tied up for 6 years. And what changed on the ground was nothing. It was just tied up. So I think part of it is to use all the tools possible. And then for the collaborative folks, make sure that you're constantly looking at new projects, new areas, new things, rather than continually going back and looking at the same project month after month. I think collaboratives, folks have come together, they're anxious and they can come together quickly on where their common ground is. Once they kind of understand each other's values, everything flows very efficiently in a collaborative. So I think I would encourage agencies to use a collaborative process as much as possible and to keep thinking as you bring folks together, stakeholders, who's missing, whose concern, whose interest is not at the table, to make sure that you've got a well-rounded, open conversation and remind everybody to park your swords at the door.
Thank you for that, Gordy. Yeah, your experience in that space is really invaluable. So thank you for that. As someone in Central Montana in the film there said, their one rule for their collaborative is leave your egos at the door. So it's a big thing. It sounds basic, but it's a big deal. And Rebecca, a message that you have that could really help with challenges you guys face.
Well, I think that folks need to know that nonprofit organizations that are within your communities are more important than ever. As government agency budgets continue to get slashed, especially if you like our federal agencies, the Forest Service in particular, have a huge mandated program of work that they can't possibly do without partners. And so getting involved with your local nonprofits and especially contributing to them, you know, the fund that we are able to raise helps to augment the work of our agencies and ultimately is benefiting the public. So while nonprofits in our communities are maybe not viewed as necessarily working for the public, we are. And we're accountable to our community. And in our case, we're also accountable not to just to our human community, but to our plant and animal and water, you know, communities that, as I mentioned, that we are equal, we are one in this landscape. And then I think to funders, like foundation funders and agency funders, to just really recognize that, you know, the importance of our groups on the ground and how we really can get a bridge both to the resources themselves and increasing their capacities, as well as to all of the humans that are impacting those resources, increasing their capacities, and to the agencies themselves. And to the public, I would say, keep being curious. And that curiosity is really key in holding your opinions lightly, leaving them at the door when you come into collaborative spaces, which admittedly is really hard. But trying to hold that lightly to allow an open mind and heart to listen. And we all need to listen to one another more. And just, like I said, at the end of the film, I think the more that we can come together, both learning, listening, leading, and fundraising, that we can have a positive impact for the future. And especially, you know, working with all those different perspectives and the incorporation of as much traditional ecological knowledge as we can, because we all have a lot to learn from each other, perhaps, but it's good to listen to the original peoples.
Absolutely. And it's and part of that listening, it's listening to land as well, right? And seeing its needs. But yeah, and what you're saying about the support of those organizations, Swan Valley Connections especially, it fills many roles in the Swan Valley. So you guys fill a lot of different roles of capacity. So, and Ron, messages that you have for folks. I know when I was speaking with you guys in the interviews, a lot of that a challenge that you guys experience with that work is just public perception. If there's something there of a message that you want to get out for folks.
Yeah, I think you hit that right on the head, Laura. You know, and listening to Gordy and the NEPA compliance, I'm guessing you're talking to, and some other things that kind of hold up projects and that type of perspective I won't tie into. But what I'll talk to you is that holding fire out of the ecosystem for 110 years with the fire suppression that we have done across the West has had obviously adverse effects to the ecosystem, our ability to stop fires right now. And you can see that with the fires that we're getting mega fires that are just prepared to roll. And for us to be able to be effective, we're going to have to do more than just reintroduce fire. We've got to do management to set the areas up so that we can reintroduce fire and maintain and control the fire behavior that we're getting and hopefully control the effects and meet the management objectives of everyone. And it's going to take some time. And we have to do more than just reintroduce fire. And then when we do reintroduce fire, you know, to be effective, to protect communities, we got to burn around communities. So you're going to live with some smoke. You're going to live with some stuff that's going to be hopefully short-lived, but it's going to be there. And it could be on the shoulder of fire season. You might have sucked smoke all August and we'll be coming into your backyard in September looking to burn more. But really what we're trying to do, you know, is manage our lands the best we can, reintroduce fire, knowing fire is on this ecosystem, it's a part of this ecosystem, it's its own spirit. We can't keep it out of it. It belongs here. So our ability to reintroduce it under our terms is a lot better scenario than the fire introducing itself in a very windy, hot August evening. So have some patience with us. Our land management activities will impact you in some form or fashion, but just understand that we're doing it for the better of the ecosystem, to protect our resources, and to protect you. So
thank you for that, Ron. Yeah, absolutely. That's those are messages we can all carry out to our own personal and professional circles to make that a part of the dialogue and that need. Thank you. And Caryn, messages that you have, or a message that you have that would help with the challenge that you guys experience.
Well, all three of the other folks, I think, summed up their positions really well, and I clearly agree with them. One of the things that I was thinking about is I think when we live in a place like the Seeley Swan, it's easy to get lulled into a sense of security and a sense that all is well and there are no problems on the landscape. And people who move here from out of state are awed by the beauty and the natural resources that are abound here. And I think folks that have lived here for generations often take for granted that, you know, what their grandparents had and their mother and father and what they have will just be here in perpetuity. And it's concerning to me that sense of, or lack, maybe better way, lack of urgency. We have climactic changes that are coming our way that are going to be significant. We have impacts on the landscape from the built environment that are increasingly being felt, whether that's related to water quality or whether that's related to habitat or whether it's related to catastrophic wildfire. All of them are going to impact the natural resources as well as the quality of life for folks that live in the Seeley Swan. So I really urge folks not to take the splendor of this environment for granted. If we want to keep it for the next generation, we're going to have to work at maintaining it, and we're going to have to help it, and we're going to have to make sure that it's a priority. So that's, I guess, what I would leave folks with, a sense of urgency.
Thank you, Caryn. Absolutely. And it's that importance of just talking about it, right? And starting that dialogue, whether it's with your neighbor or your city council member. But thank you so much.
Thank you, Laura. And I'd love to ask you a couple of questions. So while you were making this film and doing this series, I'm wondering if there were some standout surprises for you or things that you learned that you weren't expecting.
Yeah, I think it was, I grew up in the Bitter Valley in Montana, lived out of Montana for a long time and came back recently back home. And I thought I had a good grasp on my own state and the dynamics that were here. But what this project really did was open my eyes to just how little we all know, even if, we think that we're the expert in this or that, of, like you said, to come to things open. And the different areas that we covered in this series were the Seeley-Swan, the Big Hole Valley with the watershed group there, Blackfeet Nation, hearing from voices within the community of that historic relationship to the land, that disconnect that occurred between the people and the land that was forced on them, and then also this reconnection that's happening and that importance of reconnecting to the land and for the health of their communities and the land. And then the fourth one was in the central Montana plains. So all very different elements, of course, very unique ecosystems, very unique communities, but also just to see some of that overlap. I know, like in Blackfeet Nation, one of the folks we interviewed was a Blackfeet family who are also cattle ranchers, and how they incorporate their land stewardship perspective and their relationship to the land into how they their operation and how they steward the grasslands there, built based upon that traditional knowledge, and just things that I saw. A Blackfeet rancher gentleman there speaking about, and a rancher gentleman in central Montana, just the overlap in their messaging was really striking to me, to say, hey, I bet if we all got in a room together, we'd find just how much we do have in common, and really celebrating the differences and the nuances there, and that generational knowledge is very different, obviously. But really how much that advocation is similar, and how they're really both very similar in the way that they take that role of stewardship very seriously, and that they really want to plead with the public to realize just how important it is to listen to them and their community and the voices on the ground, because they haven't been listened to very much for a long time. So there's all these similarities in the messaging, but also that nuance there. So I think to me that was really neat. And also just as a filmmaker, I love to listen. I'm a listener. And I try to always show up without any opinion or anything, but we're human. And so we do that. And I think, sometimes I'd show up, and if I just say the words like, oh, I'm media from Missoula, I know images that people get. but then when you say like, no, different things about your own background, and you start to have dialogue and the things that you care about and they care about. And sometimes I'd show up and I could tell we both had opinions about each other. And then 15 minutes later, we'd be in tears together. So there are really neat moments like that too, that showed me that humanity rises above, like you're saying.
That's really neat. And so also, through this experience, did you learn ways to have dialogue? And then I guess I would open that up to anyone else. I feel like what I heard through all of our conversations was talking about that need to connect, the need to talk to one another, the need to be more informed and communicate more. And I find that really difficult, and especially in what seems to be an extraordinarily divided environment. And so anything that you learned about that or ways to inspire all of us?
Yeah, I think it's also what you're saying about that curiosity. I think that's why I do what I do, is I just have a curiosity about every profession and wildlife species and everything, that's what drives me and my work. And so I genuinely feel that when I talk to somebody, but that's a big part of how to connect with people, and just how important that is, whether it comes to you naturally or not, to really practice that. And when you do have somebody talking about something that they're interested in and they're passionate about, they may be an extremely introvert person, but you'll see they'll just open up and really blossom, and that passion will really come through. And people want to talk about the work that they're doing, because everyone's doing such amazing work, but they don't get the credit for it all the time. And so when you give them a platform to open up and share with people about that, which is what I see all that I want to do with my work, is just give that opportunity, that platform for people to share messages, you really see it come out. And I think if we just did that, even if it's just at the grocery store, you know, that we'd be really surprised at the really fun and neat connections we can make with each other. But
thank you. Thanks for that. So just to everyone, we got a comment congratulating us on a wonderful mission and a beautiful film. And so again, I really want to thank you for giving us this opportunity to connect to one another and to the public. So I guess I would open it up to see if any of the panelists have questions for each other or for Lara. But everybody's quiet tonight. And to see if there's any other questions from the public. I don't see any. I can't see the chat. I don't see any there. I really felt like this was a really fun project to work on, and I'm really excited to see all of the other episodes. Personally, I love Montana. It's my greatest love. And so I think the more too that we can learn from one another across the state, that we will find inspiration and find how much we all have in common. So again, just can't thank you enough. And thanks to all of my partners here. It's super exciting. And so I guess I wonder one other thing, if everyone would like to go around and maybe just give your contact info or the best way to learn more about your work or connect to your work. So I'll just start and say again, you know, Swan Valley Connections, you can reach us at swanvalleyconnections.org. We list all of our events and opportunities online. And so we would love to hear from folks and learn about what your needs and your curiosities or concerns are, and we'll always work to try to bring opportunities for workshops and things to the public. Caryn, you want to go next?
Sure. I can be reached at Caryn@crcmt.org, or if you want to just learn more about CRC, crcmt.org. We post all of our events on there. We post our registrations for events on there. We post our reports on there. So pretty much everything CRC, one-stop shopping.
That's great. And I also just want to commend you and call out the Southwest Crown of the Continent Collaborative, our forest network that we're both a part of. And you are managing that website on behalf of the collaborative too. If you'd like to share that information to learn more about the collaborative process, because if you are in the Seeley-Swan region or around the Southwest Crown in the Lolo Lincoln area, we'd love to have you. So do you want to share?
I don't remember it off the top of my head, so I am looking at the email address.
Thank you.
So why don't you come back to me, yeah, and I will get that.
Sounds great. Gordy, how about you?
Sure. gsanders@pyramidlumber.com. I think everyone has my phone number. So, you know, I would appreciate folks calling, because one of the issues, you know, you talk about challenges in the future too, is today's world, everyone likes to text and send emails and they don't talk to people. And so for the younger generation, we've got to figure out how to really train them that it's really okay to talk to people. But it's becoming a bigger and bigger challenge over time, to where everything becomes virtual rather than real, because you find that there's far more common ground regardless of positions people have. There's far more common ground and values, because that's the way people are.
That's really great. It's great. I get busy and you know a bunch of people and you don't call. And so thanks for that. Go ahead, Caryn. And
the Southwest Crown Collaborative is swcrown.org. So if you're interested in that organization, which is a much broader collaborative over the Seeley-Swan region, visit that website.
Perfect. Ron, you want to share your info or anything else that you want to say? Perfect.
Yeah. You're probably better off here. We are on Facebook, that CSKT Division of Fire. We have a Facebook page. And we do have an internet page as well, with the CSKT Tribes, where we give updated information, fire information, things of that nature. We're looking at trying to build some information, short stories on what we do in terms of management. Fire decisions, prescribed fire decisions, fuels treatment decisions, things of that nature, to try to build the understanding or hopefully get more support from our publics and the work that we're doing and the reason behind it. And hopefully they buy into it. And that provides that avenue for the next folks that are going to manage. But I'm with you, Gordy. Nobody calls anymore. I'll put my phone number right at the bottom. And of course, that's my extension, 6405, if you want to talk to me in person. I should have put Tony Incasola's up there. Tony is just a rock star. He did a really good job. He's a great manager, great person to work with. And I really appreciate you guys letting us be a part of this. Thank you.
Yeah, absolutely. Sad that we couldn't have Tony and Tim with us tonight, but really wonderful to get to work with you all. A beautiful thing. And Laura, how about you? A little more on Stories for Action?
Yeah, so you can check out my media brand is Stories for Action at storiesforaction.org. We do short form film primarily around social and environmental relationships and concepts. And then Life in the Land is a project you can check out at lifeintheland.org. And also on there, you will also find within each location's page, as well as on the resources page, is a link to every entity that's mentioned in this film and every other film. So including Southwest Crown Collaborative, and we've started to populate other links to other entities that are involved in this holistic collaborative approach on the land in Montana and across the country. So we really want Life in the Land to be an ongoing kind of communications catalyst to help drive this type of work forward. So we will be producing, we're going into filming two more films at the end of the summer and some more podcast episodes. And we hope to add to it with more content as we go, but also as a one-stop shop for folks to go get inspired, see what can happen, and then get equipped with resources and information and links to find out more information about these entities and connect with people in order to help drive this type of work forward. So check out lifeintheland.org. It will be always be changing. And share the information with folks as you can. And like I said, the podcasts are all on the Stories for Action series on Apple and Spotify podcasts as well. Thank you all so much for your time. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you all so much. Thank you to everyone in the audience for spending your Wednesday with us. And we hope that we'll see you on the first Wednesday in August in order for you to join in our next presentation. And you can see this and all of our previous monthly presentations, again, www.swanvalleyconnections.org, and go to our events page, in which you'll be able to see all of those recordings, including this one in the next week or so. So again, thank you all. I hope that you have a wonderful evening, and I look forward to seeing you all. And I'm gonna call you all now, being inspired by phone call conversations, and just looking forward to continuing our work together in the future. And Laura, thanks again for the opportunity. So everybody have a great evening. See you soon.
Thank you.